Okay, members of council, as we begin today's meeting, we'd like to acknowledge that we are gathering here today on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, before then the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Huron, and Wendat. We also acknowledge the many First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other global Indigenous people that now call Brampton their home. We are honored to live, work, and enjoy this land. I hope everyone in council enjoyed the Indigenous Peoples Day we had this weekend. I was speaking to our friends at the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, and they have a book on their Indigenous history that I have purchased a copy for all members of council. So when we say this, recognition every week, we can have a greater understanding of the history of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. Before we start today's meeting, I'd ask that we pause for a moment to remember those who have passed or are suffering from COVID-19, and to also reflect and think of our various frontline workers, healthcare providers, and first responders who are working so hard to serve and protect and care for all of us. Please all rise for the singing of our national anthem, to be followed by a moment of personal reflection. Welcome to our regular council meeting of June 24th. Time for O Canada and a moment of personal reflection.
O Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all of us command.
We get glowing hearts, we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, oh Canada, we stand for thee.
God keep our land,
God keep our land,
glorious and free,
glorious and free.
Oh Canada, we stand on guard for thee. Oh Canada, we stand on guard.
Okay, thank you. Welcome to our council meeting of June 24th. We'll begin the meeting with the city clerk calling for the roll call of attendance at today's meeting.
Members of council, I will be calling your name. Councillor Santos.
Here.
Councillor Visante.
Present.
Councillor Willens.
Present.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Present.
Councillor Bowman.
Present.
Councillor Medeiros.
Here.
Councillor Williams.
I'm here.
Councillor Fortini.
Here, Peter.
Thank you. Councillor Singh.
Here, present.
Councillor Dillon.
Here.
Thank you, and Mayor Brown. So all members are present, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. We're now at item 2, approval of the agenda. Do any members wish to add a business item to today's meeting? Councillor Williams.
Hi, thank you, Sue Mayor. I would like to add a brief presentation from the Brampton Library on the reopening phased plan from the acting CAO and I believe the board chair. I would also like to add a very short announcement.
Okay, is the library board chair available today?
Yes.
Okay.
The CEO is
the CEO is okay. And what's the purpose of the announcement, the clerk asked, Councillor Williams?
The Gardens of Brampton program.
Okay. And I'd also like to add a proclamation for Pride Month. Seeing no other additions, we have a motion moved by Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Singh to approve the agenda.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, I believe Councillor Medeiros was going to add an item regarding recreation and day camp recovery plans.
Councillor Medeiros, would you like to add that item?
Yes, but I believe it's supposed to be added at during your COVID update, okay. But I'm fine with that as well.
Okay, so we can do his item during my update.
Sure.
Okay, yep, the clerk says that's fine. Okay, we have a motion moved by Councillor Dillon, second by Councillor Singh. If there's any objections, please state so, otherwise you'll be recorded in favour. Any objections? Motion carries. I also want to state once again, as we're in these extraordinary times of electronic meetings, we only have myself here at City Hall, members are watching and participating virtually. We still have opportunities for the public to participate, watching the meeting remotely through the city's live stream and playback, submitting questions about the agenda through City Clerk Office at brampton.ca, and we'll read those questions out during the 15-minute public question period. And I want to let everyone know, during these extraordinary times, you can get updates regularly on the city's website at brampton.ca. And a final reminder to members of council before we start to consider today's business, please ensure your video is off and microphone is muted until you're assigned the floor, and then you can turn both on to speak. We are now at item 3, declarations of interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act. Does any member have a declaration of pecuniary interest? Hearing none, the clerk will so note for the meeting minutes. Adoption of minutes. We are now at the ready to move to the next item of business, public business, on today's council agenda, item 4. Do any members have any questions or comments regarding the minutes? If so, please use your chat function to add your name to the speaker's list. Seeing none, we have a motion moved by Councillor Singh, seconded by Councillor Dillon, to approve the minutes as published. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes. A consent motion. Our next item is 5.1, the consent motion. The items listed with a caret on the agenda are considered to be routine and non-controversial. The consent motion is to adopt those matters on today's agenda without the need for a separate discussion on items unless a member requests a separate discussion. Do any members wish to add items to consent? I can start off. I'd like to add the closed session items into consent. We have the minutes 22.1, 22.2, 22.3, the items 22.4 and 22.5 with the staff recommendation.
So through you, Mr. Mayor, if that item is, those items are added to consent, for 22.4, there is a public motion, and for 22.5, there's a public motion.
Yes.
That will be considered after the consent motion.
Okay. Are there any other consent items to be added? Hearing none, we have a motion moved by Councillor Pileschi, seconded by Councillor Williams, to approve the consent motion.
So, Mr. Mayor, we'll now bring up the motion for 22.4, first of all. Charlotte, if you can go to the end of the file. So, Mr. Mayor, the motion is on the screen. We will require a mover and seconder. It's in regard to item 22.4 on today's closed session.
Okay.
I'll move it.
Moved by Councillor Fortini and seconded by Councillor Williams. Any objections? Motion carries.
And Mr. Mayor, the next motion would be for 22.5, which will be coming on the screen momentarily. Yep. And again, we'll require a mover and seconder for that motion.
I can move that. Seconder, Acting Mayor Santos, is that okay?
Yep, it's good.
Okay. Any objections to these two motions? The motions carry. This takes us to item 6, announcements. And procedurally, it's Councillor Williams' motion first and then the Pride one.
Yes.
Okay, so Councillor Williams, your announcement.
Thank you. So many might remember a long time the City of Brampton or the Horticulture Society and Brampton would run a garden recognition program, and that program was loved by the community. People could go and visit the gardens that put their name in the running for the competition, and the Horticulture Societies would judge and award gardens who are beautiful with a first, second, or third type of recognition. Unfortunately, in 2014, that program did end, and it was to much sadness and disappointment from residents. And so after working with the Horticulture Societies of Chinkoozie and Brampton, we've been excited to bring it back. But unfortunately, with COVID, we've had to kind of change things up a little bit. And so now we are, we want to see everyone's gardens, because I know people are out there working on them. And thank you to Councillor Willens with the push for the Backyard Garden Recognition Program. It's really gotten people excited and motivated to be inspired and plant. So with this program now, we're launching a Gardens of Brampton program, which is an opportunity for residents to take pictures and send them into Brampton Green City at brampton.ca, so that the pictures of your front gardens can be featured on this website. And it's a great opportunity for us to see the talent and see the joy that and share the joy that gardening brings to each one of you, and share it with all of us. So I want to encourage everyone to, if you have a garden that you're working on this summer, please take a picture of it, send it to BramptonGreenCity@brampton.ca, or if you want to take a picture and post it on social media platforms, tag @CityBrampton and make sure to use the hashtag Gardens of Brampton. And I want to encourage everyone to go to the website, the City of Brampton, Gardens of Brampton, and see some of the beautiful gardens that are already featured on that website. So I want to encourage everyone to get out there and get gardening. And next year, we'll be able to fully launch the Garden Recognition Program in partnership with Brampton Horticulture Society and Chinkoozie Horticulture Society.
Not surprising, we have another councillor wishing to speak to this, our very own Brampton version of Frankie Flowers, Councillor Doug Willens.
Yeah, thank you. Through you, Mayor. Yeah, this is good. My mom and dad actually were part of the Horticulture Society back years ago. I just want to make clear that this is a separate program from the Backyard Garden Program, because we're doing some different things that we want to monitor and check and continue on for next year. So I saw some pictures on there. They look great. I think it's a great idea to recognize it. But can we be clear somehow that this is for the floral and shrubbery display, not for the vegetables?
Yes, absolutely. This is completely separate. This is just for front gardens, for people to take pictures of their flowers and their garden beds in the front of their homes.
Okay, excellent. Good.
It's very different. Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Great. No, good. Excellent. Good work.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Willens. Councillor Medeiros.
Yeah, my apologies, Mayor. I'm just caught at a loss, and maybe Councillor Williams can just elaborate. And you know, congratulations or thank you for the announcement. But so is this a city website? Is this something like, I'm just trying to understand, do you sit on Brampton Grows, is there a committee that we have that you're a representative, or what's the city's involvement in this?
The city has been working with the horticulture. It's a part of the Grow Green initiatives that we have at the City of Brampton. So we wanted to make sure that we, you know, continue on in that spirit of encouraging people to grow their gardens and beautify the city and their neighborhoods. So it was a great opportunity to connect with the Horticulture Societies to be able to put this on.
And, okay.
Yeah.
So my understanding then, you're the local area councillor on behalf of the horticulture, you're making that announcement.
Yes. It's we're supporting the Horticulture Societies and their the program and bringing it back and you know, doing that work. So they are the ones that are like going forward, they will be the ones that will be monitoring and doing the judging for the gardening program and the garden recognition program.
So why, sorry, I'm confused. Why would they send in the pictures to the city if it's, is it a collaboration between the city and the Horticulture Society?
Yes.
Okay, and you sit on, you represent the city of Brampton on this horticulture center? Or is it just as an area councillor?
As an area councillor. Well, I have been, I'm the Chinkoozie Horticulture Society is east side of Brampton and of Bramley area, and they have been for many, many years. And so we've been in discussion with them, and we've been in discussion with the Brampton Horticulture Society, because it wouldn't be fair to just do one side of Brampton. It should be all residents being able to participate. So we've been in great conversation with all of them, and the community is so excited to see a program like this come back again, because it really encourages people to take pride in their neighborhoods. And yeah, it's been great, great feedback and excitement.
Yeah, and my apologies, Councillor Williams. I was just confused if this was some committee I wasn't aware of, and you're making the announcement on behalf of your stakeholder. That's fine. Thank you very much.
Okay. And we certainly are grateful for the efforts of the Horticultural Society. Councillor Santos.
Thank you so much. I think it's great. I'm wondering, how is it that these gardens get awarded and acknowledged and recognized?
These gardens won't be acknowledged and recognized and judged this year. This is just the picture garden, Gardens of Brampton picture initiative. Because of COVID, we're not encouraging people to go and visit gardens in the neighborhood. So as time progresses and we continue to work on and evolve this, we will be able to come out with more information on what the horticulture societies are going to do to help judge award people prizes for this program.
Okay, awesome. Because I remember in 2018, Councillor Vicente and I, when we were walking around the neighborhood, we would see signage of the local area councillors on front lawns acknowledging gardens, and I think that's nice, but I also think it's a way of campaigning. So I just want to make sure that when time comes for acknowledging and rewarding and recognizing, we recognize the garden, and it's not just a way to get incumbent councillor names out on front lawns. Thanks.
Yeah, so this program was stopped in 2014, and it wasn't endorsed by council back then in 2014. So anything after that would have just been individual councillors working on that, not the Horticulture Societies. Horticulture Societies is a community initiative, and it would be the Horticulture Societies providing recognition to any of gardens moving forward, not individual councillors.
Okay, we can talk about that when the time comes for recognition. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Fratini.
Thank you. Just a couple of questions. So have the chair or the vice president of this culture, have they asked for this? Because Dennis Farmington lives up the street, and also Ruth, he's in Martin's Materials area. And do they know about this?
If they are members of the Horticulture Society, they would be, because the Horticulture Society's the presidents have been in constant conversation with their members about this. And, I'm surprised there's so many questions about this, because it's such a positive initiative for the community. And, we just want to see beautiful gardens showcased. And so I'm really hoping that that's what we're going to be focusing on moving forward.
Oh, no, that's not, I understand that. Well, I remember back then it was there and everyone got a plaque. They did. But I know Dennis Farmington up the street from me, and also Ruth, she's in Ward 3, and they're part of it. And we were talking last week and never mentioned anything. So, this is good that we bring it back. I'd like to ask staff, why was it removed in the first place at the beginning in 2014? The staff, do we know why?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. This is Derek Boyce speaking. I have to get back to you on that before my time here at the city, so I'm not sure why it was removed, but I can get back to you, Council, with further information on that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. And, it's a good thing. I remember everyone was just to get these, these plaques around, and I think there was a little bit of problems in competition, but it's a good thing that people put work into their front lawns and enough competition. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Councillor Fratini. Thank you, Councillor Williams. There's no motion with that item, it's just an announcement. That takes us to our next item, announcement 6.2, and this is my item on Pride Month. As you know, July is Pride Month in Brampton. So whereas gay pride celebrations have become common in Canadian cities and the Pride Committee of Peel is celebrating 17 years of Pride Week throughout the Peel region, it remains important to recognize the essential worth of every human person to promote the development of harmonious relationships amongst all members of the community. Discrimination against gays, lesbians, bisexual, and transgender community must be prevented. Awareness and acceptance of this community is crucial to an inclusive society. And this is proclaimed for July 2020, Pride Month. And I should just note, you know, last year we had some wonderful celebrations. The reception at City Hall, the sidewalk unveiling crossing. We had our participation at the International Toronto Pride Parade. We had those shirts that said, love is love is love, and Brampton is proud of our LGBTQ plus community. And it's not the same this year, but we're having the proclamation, and I'm sure next year we can have many events celebrating the community in Brampton. But I just have to say, I thought last year was beautiful, and thank you to all the members of council that participated in those activities. That takes us to government relations matters. Oh, Councillor, I'm told Councillor Pelleschi might have a question.
No question, Mr. Mayor, just thanks for bringing this forward. It's, I was on to speak for the Gardens of Brampton recognition, but I also wanted to just say that I'm, thank you, Mr. Mayor, for bringing this forward. I love participating every year and for a great, great cause. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Singh has a question.
Yeah, Mayor, I do. For Pride Month, have we done any shareables from the City of Brampton? I haven't seen them, and so this is just a question to communications, because I would like to share something on my...
Looking over to Jason Tammy, can we have some graphics done up for Pride that we can share?
Yeah, and councillors can support, and from the central account as well.
Yes, Mayor, I will. We'll get something to council shortly. Thank you.
Great idea, Councillor Singh. Thank you for that suggestion. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, this takes us to government relations matters for the presentation, Councillor Santos will take the chair during the government relations presentation as I step out for a moment to take a call.
Thank you, and through the Mayor. Brampton has officially entered into stage two of the province's reopening framework. This morning, we received a small provincial update. The province has extended the declaration of emergency through to July the 15th. As a reminder, this week is Regional Council, so that's tomorrow, as well as Peel Housing Corporation meeting taking place from 9 to 9:30 a.m. Work is also continuing behind the scenes to prepare for AMO, and further information will be coming out as needed. We've also sent out emails for all the councillors that are interested in registering, attending AMO, if they could just let us know and we could finish everything for you on your behalf. And those are all the announcements I have for today. If there are any questions, please let me know. I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Thank you. Do any members of council have any questions on Verdeep's presentation on government relations? I see no questions. Thank you. I think we need to receive.
I have a question.
Councillor Pelleschi, go ahead.
I think Councillor Vicente was before me, Madam Chair.
I apologize. Councillor Vicente followed by Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Madam Acting Mayor. Question to staff. In the government relations report, there is a mention of some funding that is to be provided to Peel Memorial Hospital. Can we get some more detail on that?
Thank you, through the chair, Councillor. May I revert back to you with further details in an email? Would that be okay?
That would be fine. I think that if there is a funding announcement that was made by the provincial government with regards to Peel Memorial Hospital, we would want people in the community to be aware of that if there is, in fact, an investment. And so I would just flag that for staff And I had another question, but I can't remember it right now. If it comes to me, it might be COVID-19 related. I can ask it later during the COVID-19 portion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Vicente. Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Madam Acting Mayor. My question related to 10.2 on the agenda for Regional Council, Appeal 2041 Regional Official Plan Review, Municipal Comprehensive Review. I'd like to hear from planning staff to give us kind of a background on what we're doing, how we're working with the region on this, and then what is, and we go through official plan reviews as well. When is our next official plan review for conformity?
Thank you, Councillor. Is Commissioner Forward participating today? That question was for planning.
Good afternoon, Councillor. It is Richard here. So yes, we our official plan is under review right now. It is started last fall. Can you hear me?
Sorry. I can hear you.
Okay. Yeah, it started last fall, so it's underway. Well underway. As far as our participation with the region, yes, we do comment on their official plan, and we can provide the details, Council, through an email to members of Council.
Thank you. Okay. Is that good enough, Councillor Pelleschi?
Yep. My other question was related to the update on the water main and sanitary sewer for the downtown core being paused. It doesn't indicate the way that these used to come up in previous councils was that there was a recommendation by the city, and there doesn't seem to be many recommendations in these in these notes for GR. What is our position on the water main, the sanitary sewers, with everything that's going on currently in the downtown? Can I get a comment on that?
Thank you, Councillor. I believe that's a public works question. Commissioner Saini, if you are available.
Yes, this is Jasbir here. Through you, Acting Mayor. Yes, Councillor, we are bringing a report with the full details. The report is coming on the next council session, and the region appeal has already done a report, and we are doing a follow-up report. It will cover everything.
So we're currently at the city, we're currently going through the regional report.
Region has, because this is a collaborative effort for this project, because there is a road resurfacing, and we are also doing a combination of the funding model. So what this report, the region has gone to their council, and they will talking about what is the procedure and different options. And once they do it, so no, we are following up with that report, and we will bring a report with all the details.
So, okay. So, but we've already at the city looked at the region's report. We've worked through with them through the report. Are we happy with what's being presented to regional council tomorrow? Would you like to see anything different as far as members of council who sit at the region to implement change or to do anything to the report?
No, we are fully, it was a collaborative effort. So both the CEOs and both the commissioners with all the managers, we had numerous meetings with them. So it was we are fully supportive of them, whatever is going into the council.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much. Back to you, Madam Acting Chair.
Thank you very much, Councillor Pelleschi, and thank you, Commissioner Reyna. I think Councillor Vicente has remembered his question. Go ahead.
Thank you, Acting Madam Chair. I just wanted to say that again. And question with regards to the update on the surplus food rescue program. It mentions here that there is an open application process for surplus food rescue program. How could we support our local food bank agencies to help them in navigating this, whatever this process is that is described here in the GR update? was that heard? Yeah.
Yes, thank you to the chair. I think you're discussing the program that was announced on June the 15th, 2020?
Correct.
Okay.
Through your chair.
Thank you, Councillor.
Yeah, just looking for staff, if they can provide some assistance on how we can assist our local food banks to take advantage of this 50 million surplus food rescue program.
Absolutely. Thank you for the question. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to look into this, and I can also send this information to all of council in an email of how we can take part in this program.
Thank you, because it sounds like a very good opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Vicente. I'll probably add that this is something for us to note at the Social Support Task Force as well. Any further questions from members of council? I see nothing further. We have a motion by Councillor Willen, seconded by Councillor Pelleschi, to receive the report and the presentation. Anyone opposed? Those who do not indicate opposition, that your count will be, your vote will be counted in the affirmative. Okay. That motion carries. 8.1. Our next item is delegations. Public notice was issued by the city regarding the bylaw to facilitate temporary outdoor patio expansions in an effort to mitigate the effects of COVID-19. This relates to proposed bylaws 103, 2020 on today's agenda. In place of in-person delegations, written delegations are accepted regarding this matter. And Mr. Clerk, do we have any written delegations submitted?
We do not, Madam Chair.
Okay. Seeing none, we can move on to the next business item.
I have my name on the board. Sorry, Acting Mayor.
I apologize, Councillor Fortini. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Acting Mayor. I just wanted to ask some questions to staff about this, because I've been getting a lot of calls to do this patio. They're saying it's going to take weeks and weeks and weeks. They want to send letters to the residents. And so I just want some clarification. If we're going to have to take like 5 to 7 weeks to get this done, their summer's over. We should have this done very fast and quickly. And I want to know what the procedures are to get this done. And there's no website out online where they could actually go and just apply for like a quick permit. So I'd like to ask staff, how does this get done so fast?
So through you, Mr. Chair, I'll start. It's Peter. The bylaw that's before council today is going to be authorizing and delegating the clerk the responsibility for issuing the temporary outdoor patio extension permits. And council will be resolving the committee of council recommendation from last week to implement the program. There is a website and a page already live on brampton.ca. If somebody does a search for Patio Brampton, which is the name for the program, they will get a website that will a web page that will explain the process steps, and there will be an online application form that businesses can apply for. I just looked before coming into today's meeting, and we already have 12 applications that have been submitted, and staff are processing those applications. I do want to point out, though, that it depends. Every application is different. So there are applications that are looking to extend or create outdoor patios on private property. If the business is not the property owner, they will require, as part of their application, an authorization of approval or consent from the property owner. If their proposal includes taking away from a plaza or a parking lot that's associated with the property, there may be a requirement for an agreement that is a way to, as efficiently as possible, deal with the planning requirements and the Planning Act requirements, so the city did not have to pursue a temporary use bylaw. And those provisions were set out last week in the report that was provided to Committee of Council. If the property is on public property, whether it's a right-of-way, a public sidewalk, or property that's owned by the municipality, there will also have to be what's effectively called a licensing agreement, because the city will have to give approval to use a portion of the public property for an outdoor patio. While we will try as quickly as possible and as efficiently as possible to deal with these requests, there will be required clearances provided by fire, by building division, by zoning, by realty if it involves city property. And all of that is to protect, obviously, the public health and safety of the patrons that will be attending those temporary outdoor patios. But also we want to balance that with, we want to be as efficient as possible to allow the businesses to open their patios. So there, it is a process. We will do it as quickly as possible. We've committed in our emails back to applicants that we will get back to them within 2 days, if not less. I can tell you that we are actively working with all the departments now on the 12 applications that have been submitted so far.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Yes, 2 or 3 days, a week, that would be fine. I know I got some emails, and I think you got some too, and they're just telling me, like, all these hurdles, by the time we do all these hurdles, our summer will be gone. And I know it's a temporary one. Some people want to have a permanent one, and I keep telling them, if you want to do a permanent, get the temporary one now. You want to do a permanent, you have to go through the process. But through the temporary one, we got to try to be as fast as we can. And I want to thank you. I know you replied to some people, and I told them, just, you know, the safety comes first, and I agree. We can't just start putting a rope across a parking lot, and there you go. And they do need the condo corp or the owner of the plaza to agree. If they don't want to do it, there's nothing we could do. Okay, so long, 2 or 3 days, that's great. Thank you so much, Peter.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Medeiros?
Thank you, through you, Chair. Yeah, and Peter, thank you. Just echoing Councillor Fortini, thank you for the turnaround. What I'm finding in terms of some of these issues just recently, it's exactly as what the discussion was, that cafes and bars and other things have approached me, but then after they don't have any agreement with their landlord, and that seems to be an issue, because the timing to get authorization, some of these plazas are corporately run, so their contact person is a little bit, so that seems to be one. The second is the understanding of what type of structure that we consider to be a patio. And I know I sent something over to you, which was not even in my area, and Councillor Vicente and myself visited that place today. And essentially it's a little cafe that has a big sidewalk on a private property on the plaza, and they just want to put a couple tables out. So I think that clarification, there are other establishments who've suggested the same, that instead of putting that expenditure of a full blown patio, they'd like to put one or two tables adjacent to their front window. So I don't know, what are we silent on that, or is it, you know, what's the process, or what is the speak, like, what should I tell them regarding something like that? Is that something that has to still require a temporary permit? Are they allowed to right now just put a little table adjacent to their thing, especially if it's on private property?
Through you, Madam Chair, if it is on private property, and they're not the business owner, they will require some consent or approval by the property owner. If it is a sidewalk, a wide sidewalk as an example, and it is city property, it still will require some type of approval by the municipality. It may appear to be very quick and easy, and it may in fact be, but the city has a responsibility to ensure that there's still a safe path of travel for pedestrians on the sidewalk. Accessibility provisions are maintained. So all of those things still have to be considered. And we are certainly mindful that we want to do this as expeditiously as possible.
Now, in a lot of these, and just lastly, a lot of these establishments aren't so tech savvy to be able to do things online. What is their recourse?
Through you, Madam Chair, if there are businesses that are having difficulty with the online application system, and it is relatively straightforward, there's a series of questions to fill in. Some are mandatory, some are not, and they submit as much as they can, or they make an inquiry. Okay. They can send an email to cityclerk's office@brampton.ca, and we will be in contact with them to find if there's another way to submit the information. We do require the information electronically, just so we can have the review that is required from all the departments across the city, which must happen electronically just because of physical distancing.
Yep.
And separation of everybody that's involved.
Okay. Thank you very much, Peter. And I do appreciate how extraordinary time this is, and what a sort of a process that is going to, I'm sure, bring up other sort of issues. But thank you very much for everything you're doing.
Thank you. And Madam Chair, if I just want to add that if one thing that hasn't been discussed, if alcohol sales is involved and the establishment does have a liquor license and they want to move that and serve liquor outside, Another requirement through the AGCO, and it's a municipal requirement, is that area, that patio, will have to have some type of fence. So we would work with the applicant on that. So there is a delineation or a boundary between where alcohol may be served outdoors and the rest of the public realm.
Thank you very much. Mr. Clerk, I am noticing that in this section we have item 12.1. Is there anything that we need to bring forward from item 12.1 that we can deal with now?
Through you, Madam Chair, no. If it's dealt with in agenda order, and then when we get to the bylaw is adopted, and then at the end of the meeting, Perfect. The temporary patio program will be in effect.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So our next item is 8.2, a staff presentation on Brampton's participation in Collision from Home, June 23rd to 25th, 2020, and that is this week. And we are very excited to hear from Claire Barnett from Economic Development. Go ahead and welcome Claire.
Thanks very much, Councillor. I have a short presentation to go through. Appreciate the opportunity to present the work that the city has been doing during Collision from Home. It has been happening this week, all virtually, all online. The decision was made in March to move the conference to online, and rather than it taking place in Toronto this year. So to provide you a bit of background and context as to what is Collision, it is a business that is based in Dublin, Ireland, and they hold events around the world that are tech focused. You would have heard of our participation at Web Summit in Lisbon, Collision in Toronto, and Rise, which is in Hong Kong. They are all focused on the markets in which they exist. So the Collision one is really focused on the North American market. Forbes really calls it the fastest growing and best tech conference in the world. It's been called the Olympics of tech conferences. So the attendees include founders and CEOs of tech companies, fast-growing startups, heads of states, and they're really responding to the question of what comes next. So 100 countries are represented, over 800 investors with 32,000 attendees. That includes over 1,000 startups and 600 speakers. So I'd like to thank Mayor Brown and Council for your engagement and your support. It has been really interesting to be involved in a conference that has gone completely virtual. There were some tech challenges that the organization has been working through, but as the whole world has moved to working from anywhere, we really need to adapt our business development and marketing plans to be able to market Brampton and develop investment leads online. Next slide, please. So ahead of the conference, we began working on our lead generation and social media marketing activities. Could I have the next slide, please? It was a priority to set up meetings ahead of time with the attendees, along with marketing Brampton at the conference itself. We connected with businesses that we met with in Lisbon during Web Summit last fall that unfortunately could not visit Collision this spring. And we've been having meetings with them to ensure that Brampton is still in the investment decision-making for their new investment. We've really been promoting the Innovation District, and we've done a lot of social media. That what I'm showing you now are a couple of tiles that we've been sending out to really pre-qualify meetings with investors. The team has been very, very busy over the last couple of days. The mayor has been meeting with some businesses as well, was very excited to have a meeting yesterday with an American multinational who hadn't had Brampton on their radar. They have a presence in Waterloo, but they were really excited to hear the things that we've been doing. Can I have the next slide, please? So our marketing included a great partnership with our colleagues in communications. So thank you for their support. The mayor participated in the City Summit, which was a panel of international mayors talking about the role of the Chief Exploration Officer. That's really about ensuring that organizations, private sector or public sector, have innovation in their DNA. We've been promoting Brampton through other areas as well. This is a very exciting session this afternoon with Randy Assay, who is actually a client of the Brampton Entrepreneur Center. And he set up a creative and marketing branding agency and also the first ever athlete-focused tech conference, which connects athletes with business and tech entrepreneur opportunities. So it's exciting to have somebody who will be speaking with NBA stars who have set up tech companies, and it will be Brampton's Randy Asse who will be moderating that conversation. We're excited to see that. We also shared a video ahead of two speakers. One was Shaquille O'Neal, and one was an Indian businessman, Vinod Khosla. And we had thousands of people in the audience who saw our video, which you can see on our new website. We didn't want to play it at council in case there were some tech challenges. Next slide, please. So what are we saying when we're talking to these people? We really focus our conversations on the Innovation District, as I mentioned. We're inviting startups and multinationals to be a part of what we're building, to be a part of a new Innovation District. Next slide, please. We promote the fact that Brampton is physically located in the center of the Innovation Corridor, Canada's Innovation Corridor. Many people would have heard of Toronto or Waterloo. This really grounds our physical presence and also gives us a brand of being the global center of talent and innovation. Next slide, please. And based on talent, talent is really the one piece of our conversation with all of these businesses that they're extremely interested in hearing about. So we tell them about the access to 21 universities and colleges within an hour's drive from Brampton. We speak about our partners like Sheridan, Ryerson, Algoma, and the Brampton University Movement to ensure that they know that within Brampton, they would have access to incredible international and diverse talent as well. Next slide, please. And finally, what we speak about that really attracts attention is our cybersecurity sector that's been growing. The work that we do with the Rogers Cybersecure Catalyst, which again leads to talent. It leads to the accelerator that will be opening in the fall, growing startups based in cybersecurity. And then the third piece is the cyber range that the Catalyst will be launching as well, that it's really about the first and one of the only in Canada, if not North America, a cyber range, which is attracting attention from global players where they can test their infrastructure. And that will be something that we will be able to promote much more in the fall as well. Next slide, please. So to conclude, thank you very much for the opportunity to present what we've been doing at Collision this week. It's been great. We've been very well received. We've really put Brampton on the map. People are really impressed with our value proposition being around talent and innovation. People certainly have noticed and we get a lot of attention because of the focus on cybersecurity. And we hopefully will welcome many visitors that we met in Lisbon as well as through Collision from Home. We will be inviting them to the Innovation District, and we really look forward to having a big opening and a big announcement when people can travel again. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Councillor Santos, for temporarily taking the chair there. I had a Zoom call with Wayne Gretzky to quickly attend to, and he said to say to everyone he loved playing hockey in Brampton and sends his best. In terms of Claire's presentation, I just wanted to say, first of all, Claire, thank you for the great work. Your passion for economic development in the city is certainly noticed and appreciated. But Collision and the Web Summit, which are hosted by Patty Gosgrove, are the two largest tech conferences in the world, and the who's who of economic development and growing companies are part of this. I had the chance to go to the Web Summit with Councillor Medeiros and Vicente, and the scale and the scope of it just blows your mind. We were really excited about this year's Collision in Toronto. As you know, John Tory has been a huge champion of this. And because rent is prohibitive in Toronto and there are some real financial advantages in Brampton, you know, we had hoped that this Collision conference, we would be able to do tours of Brampton. We were going to get a day set aside for those that would come and visit. We've had a lot of interest. Obviously, COVID changes it. Now it's virtual, and I'm grateful that we've been still able to make the best of it. We're doing all these virtual meetings, one-on-one meetings over Skype with virtual attendees. And I can tell you there's a lot of interest in our innovation district, a lot of interest, a ton of interest in what we're doing on cybersecurity, a lot of interest on our startup incubator. So I really think the emphasis the city is putting on technology is going to pay dividends in the years ahead. You know, these are jobs of tomorrow, and Brampton's getting noticed. The fact that we had, you know, a multinational company asking about Brampton is a great sign. You know, we want to get into the space. We want these jobs here. So Claire, I just want to say keep up the great work, and looking forward to continue to see Brampton being aggressive on chasing these technology jobs. We have a few questions. I think Councillor Medeiros is first.
Thank you, Mayor Brown, and thank you. I echo your comments in terms of you know, all the great work associated specifically with this file and with this conference. My question, Claire, is around interesting with COVID-19, how it's dragged people like myself who were somewhat technologically challenged on. Besides, you know, my iPhone, and it's essentially been a catalyst to really force people to look at technology as platform, businesses to look at, you know, using that as a platform for their products and services. Now, does this conference have any sort of focus on, you know, that transition? Because before, you know, having attended the conference, you know, there seemed to be this sort of subculture I did not know, and everyone speaks the lingo. But it seems now with COVID-19, it's really, you know, brought a lot of people into that sphere. So is there any sort of, do you find with some of the subject matters, do you find with anything that, you know, they're really trying to provide some solutions and some platforms during this COVID-19 and moving forward? And anything along those lines?
Claire, can you hear us?
Hi, can you hear me?
Go ahead.
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yep.
Okay, great, thank you. Thank you for the question. Absolutely, there's a lot of content on the platform. So to describe it for those of you who weren't able to make it on yet, there are 32,000 people going on this platform that has 5 different channels of programming going on at the same time, as well as workshops. And a lot of the workshops are focused on the workplace of the future, the cities of the future, different positions that certainly don't exist now in many organizations that will be required to help organizations become more technical. But you're quite right, a lot of the attendees have already been there. They certainly work from anywhere. I would say the one thing that is of great interest to us in economic development is this the future of the way conferences are going? So we heard yesterday that MedTech, which is the conference we attended in Boston in September, was to be hosted in Toronto in October. It is going all virtual as well. So we are going to have to adapt as well, not just as users of technology, but using technology and how can we market Brampton for investment through these different platforms. So that will definitely be something that we are going to have to learn how to adjust and adapt the way we work. I will also say that team has done all of this virtually with councillors and mayor participation. None of us have been under the same roof. So we've all adapted very well to this, I think.
Councilor Medeiros, any additional questions?
Oh, no, thank you very much, Claire, and thank you, Mayor Brown.
Okay, Councilor Pelleschi.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Claire. You just answered the question that I had as well, and but I did still have a comment, and my comment was, like, as being a member of council on this term,
there's been a lot of change, and there's a big difference in how council participates with economic development and everything that that is currently happening within the office is really exciting, and I'm sure all members of council agree. When you know we're being a little bit, I feel like I am being a little bit more included in into some of the discussions and some of the happenings that are going on. And so that's a big thanks to you, Claire. I guess I'll also wish you a happy belated birthday as well. Mr. Mayor, the thanks goes to you as well for some of the guidance that you've provided us on these files. And it's definitely a really exciting time when you see presentations like this and past presentations. It's an exciting time to be not only a council member but a resident of Brampton for sure. Thank you very much.
Councillor Bowman.
Thank you very much through you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Claire. After some initial difficulties yesterday morning, I finally was allowed to get on there. I don't know what the holdup was, but thank you for working with me through that. I've been watching for a couple of days now, and it will be on tomorrow again. There are some great interviews on there with some people who are talking about the connected cities, the green cities. Right before our meeting today, I was online listening to a speaker on connected cities, and he was right here in Toronto talking about how technological change is going to affect every single SME and large organization across not only Canada, but across the world, especially with COVID and with restrictions on traveling. But some of the really interesting things that I've been listening to and watching are the marketing experts talking about how there's going to be a 180 degree shift in how products and services are marketed due to COVID-19 and what's going to happen in the future. So thank you for including me in on the WebEx, or not the WebEx, but the conference. It is interesting, and it goes on till I think 5 o'clock tonight, and then again tomorrow from 9:30 until 4:30. So I'll be listening and watching again. Thank you very much, Claire.
And any members of council that wish to watch and are having challenges, just let Claire know. But there's another, there's more content to come, and it really is impressive. If you don't know about Collision, just look it up online, and it's it is pretty impressive. I don't see any other questions. So we have can we have this moved and seconded? I'm happy to move it, seconded by Councilor Medeiros. Is that okay? Councilor Medeiros, is that okay to have you as the seconder?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, any objections to moving this report, this presentation? Seeing none, the motion carries.
So, Mr. Mayor, the next presentation would be the added presentation from the library.
Okay.
I'll bring in the library staff.
So, John Simone and Susan Bartoletta have joined the meeting. And John, you can please proceed. We'll bring up the presentation in a moment.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, and specifically Councillor Williams and Councillor Singh for inviting the library to present. As Mr. Fay mentioned, I'm here with my colleague, Susan Bartoletta, to provide an update on the library phases. We had a board meeting yesterday, and there was some great dialogue and discussions regarding the phases. We did circulate a full version of our presentation to the board, but we've also provided an abbreviated version given the time constraints that we have here. So we are very excited to introduce service to the residents of Brampton, but we will do so cautiously with staff and resident being of utmost importance in how we proceed. We've been working closely with the BMO group and the incident management team as we developed our phases and as support for protective equipment. The management team has developed a five-phase approach to reopening library services. But before I go through the phases, I thought it was worth mentioning that since our closure, we've been focused on providing virtual services, e-books and e-resources for our residents, for the residents of Brampton, and we have seen significant growth in usage, and there has been a lot of demand for these services. So as we went through the development of these phases, we did assess risk, and the risk in those various phases helped identify the controls that we require to provide these services. We worked with our health, we've developed health and safety procedures and protocols that have been reviewed and approved by the Ministry of Labor. We've also been working with our Joint Health and Safety Committee. We've also been referencing and using documentation that was prepared for or prepared by the city, which included the facilities mitigation action plan and development of our procedures. So although we've developed five phases, our plan and how we plan to move forward within the various phases is obviously from the learnings that we get from the phases that we are currently in, and those will help strengthen the controls that we have in place and learn as we move forward. So jumping into the phases, and if you can move to the second slide. So this abbreviated presentation that we've provided highlights the five phases for the Brampton Public Library. As we move into phase one and what phase one is, it's really to have our branches get reacclimatized with their branch, getting them back in to check in materials and help prepare for phase two. Although our branches were closed, we did keep our drop boxes open, so that way our residents could drop our materials so that way we can quarantine them properly. We are following quarantine procedures as advised by the region and the province. What we do know is that a 72-hour quarantine will help support proper isolation of them, or isolation of materials for up to 72 hours will help properly quarantine and remove any potential risk of virus being transferred. So on the fourth day, those materials, any books or any items that we have will be recirculated for customer use or for resident use. As we move into, before I end, our target for phase one, and I guess the importance to come to council, is that we plan to have our staff go into our branches for early next week. We will have staff go in and prepare and for phase two. As we move into phase two is really to provide a contactless curbside service, similar to what you would find going to a Home Depot. You would call in and pick up your materials. So from a stage one perspective, though, we are limiting it to holds. To explain what a hold is prior to the closure, a customer would have called in, made a request for a material. We would hold that material for the customer to either come into the branch and pick it up. So for our stage one of that service, we plan to contact those customers with holds and have them picked up. We are looking for a two-week push from that and hope to launch that service for mid-July. And again, so it'd be curbside. A customer would come in, identify that they have the material, they are coming by to pick up the material. Our staff would go outside, put the material in their trunk, and the customer will drive away with the item. Once we've completed all those holds, we will move into stage two in our phase two of curbside pickup, which essentially allows for customers to make general requests on our website. It would still be through a curbside service, and we anticipate that to happen shortly thereafter we finish phase one. So again, as I mentioned, as we move through the phases, we will be learning and taking what we've learned within those phases and apply them to the other phases. I think it's also important to note as well that for the curbside services, we're not planning to offer them at all our branches. We're planning to offer them at limited branches spread throughout the city for limited hours. This will allow us to, again, control any risks and assess the demand and how it goes. If we can, we will expand that service. Moving into phase three, which we anticipate that to happen in August or thereabouts. Again, taking that learning experience from the previous phase, we will plan to offer extended service in one of our branches for limited hours. What those services will include would be access to materials, access to computers. Those computers will be based and used on a reserve basis. So that way, once it was used, it could be brought back for cleaning and quarantining and then recirculated again. So it would be limited, limited service, but being providing much needed service that our customers or residents need, like Wi-Fi, like access to some materials. And sorry about that. Access to materials, and it would be on a reserve basis for computer usage. Again, we are assessing the risks accordingly throughout, but we do have dependencies, and a lot of it has to do with access to proper protocols in place, having the right protective equipment in place, working closely with the city's facilities team to ensure we're properly cleaning, and following the protocols and procedures that were in place by the region and the province. Moving on to the next slide, thank you, is our phase four. And essentially phase four is an expansion of our curbside to all our branches. Actually, curbside will be offered at all our branches in phase three, but we will continue to offer curbside in the beginning stages of phase four. But we will also expand all like more services throughout more branches. So in phase three, we're offering it in one branch. We plan to expand those that service in more of our branches, but we plan to do that in a safe manner, a controlled manner, following the physical distancing protocols that are in place, ensuring that we have the substantial barriers in place. We are working with the city to install acrylic barriers at all our service stations. And again, it would minimize the interaction to ensure that there is physical distancing in place. We will increase some of our services. We don't plan to offer any live programs, in-branch programs within any of the first four phases, but we will continue to provide our virtual services and continue to provide services that we've offered in the previous phases. Moving forward, and as a potential target date for phase four, an expansion of more branches and more services, we plan to launch it in September. And again, taking the learnings from phase four, we will further expand in phase 4B. Eventually, what we will do is we'll stop with the curbside, but we'll also look at offering visiting library services. And what that is providing service for our seniors, those who cannot come into our branches. We will try to expand service and offer and deliver our materials to those who can't come in. And then going into phase five, we're hoping to resume regular hours and services. We'll need to determine what those services are, but as we go forward, it'll be obviously based on further protocols, further guidance from the region, further guidance from the city and from the province and how we deliver our services. But we will definitely be reviewing, and we do have a target. We do say January, but it could be end of 2020 or potentially beginning of 2021. So what you see there is kind of a high level version of our presentation. We did provide more of a fulsome presentation as well, but being that we were graciously added on, we try to keep it within a timely manner.
Okay, yeah, thank you for the presentation. I don't see any questions. We need a motion to receive the motion from Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Fortini. Oh, sorry, Councillor Singh. Councillor Singh has been a board member. Councillor Williams and Singh to accept the presentation from the Brampton Library.
Thank you very much.
Seeing no objections, the motion carries. This takes us to my update. This takes us to 9.1, my weekly COVID-19 update. We've had some good news recently. We're now in stage two. The physical distancing is working. We are making progress. I mentioned today that William Osler continues to be one of the top testing hospitals in the province of Ontario. We're always one or two with Ottawa. As of today, we've tested 61,023 individuals. So that's great news. From a testing perspective, we have the next pop-up testing center, which will take place Friday, June 26th, from 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. at the city's Gore Meadows Community Center. And of course, South Fletcher continues to be open every day. Just yesterday, 560 people got tested at South Fletcher's. From June 16th to June 23rd, 4,361 residents got tested. We're also seeing people are starting to comply better with the rules around physical distancing. Only 17 charges had to be laid last week. And as part of the reopening of stage two, I announced today with Councillor Medeiros that our summer camps are going to be back on. That's allowed under stage two. Registration opens June 29th. They'll be running starting July 13th for children ages 4 to 10. Splash pads will be open June 27th. Outdoor basketball courts, Councillor Dillon, if you're listening, outdoor basketball courts will be available for use beginning June 26th, not for games, but for practice. Cricket would be allowed for practice, but not for games, as long as there's less than 10 players. Our rinks will be open June 29th for training and practice, not contact, maximum of 10 participants with no access to change rooms. July 3rd, sports fields will be available for permitted use by affiliates and major user groups. A maximum of 10 participants will be allowed per field, including coaches. Field rentals will be available for general public starting July 6th, and very soon we're going to be reopening, hopefully in early July, Professor's Lake. And garage sales are now allowed in Peel. So that's a lot of information, a lot of changes, and I would encourage members of council to support local businesses. They've been it's been a tough go, and patios are now open. Thank you for Councillor Fortini for your leadership on that, making it easier to set up a patio. Well, let's get out and use one. I promised my friend Denny Keenan that I'm going to visit the Keenan's Irish Pub tomorrow to check out his patio, and I'm sure there's some other patios in the city. Everyone has patios that they appreciate, and hopefully every councillor can show a photo on social media of supporting a local business over the next few days and checking out their patio. It's been a tough, tough go, and I'm hoping these patios will help our restaurants. A lot of them, you know, a lot of sweat and toil has gone into building successful restaurants in our community. I hope with the patios open, it's going to make this period a little bit easier. For those dying for haircuts, not to single out Councillor Bowman, haircuts are now allowed as well. Nail salons, tattoos, those are all permitted uses under stage two. And so I want to say to the public, good job. For those listening, good job. Our case counts went down over the last few weeks, and we're making progress. But, you know, as Dr. Lawrence Lowe said this morning, this relaxing of the rules is not letting up on the guidelines. We still need to follow the guidelines of public health on physical distancing and on wearing a mask. And Dr. Lowe has said, although he's not going to mandate it in private facilities, it's a strong recommendation. And he said if the numbers go up, he would consider making it mandatory in all private facilities. Right now, in city facilities, we're encouraging the practice to wear a mask, mandatory on Brampton Transit, mandatory on the farmers market, which will be opening this Saturday. I know Councillor Willens has been eager to get some fresh produce at the farmer's market. Well, that will be open again this Saturday. I'm looking forward to going down. And wearing masks will be mandatory. We'll be giving some masks out at the first farmer's market. That's a quick summary of the issues that we've had in the last week. I know we're going to have some supplementary motions. Should we deal with those first, or go to questions first? It's your choice. Why don't we deal with the correspondence, and then we'll go to questions. We've had correspondence from Terry Miller, president of Brampton Carp, and that's in item 9.1. And then we also have correspondence from the Girls Softball Association and Brampton Minor Baseball, and that one has an associated resolution. Can we get that resolution on the screen? So this was raised by some of our amateur sports organizations, asking us to do some advocacy when it came to the liability they face. And this is from our legal department. They had a suggestion of advocacy we could do to the provincial government. Do we have that?
It's coming on right
now. Oh, here it is. This is something the Attorney General could do to help with amateur sports organizations concerned about liability in regards to COVID-19. So I'm happy to move this, and if there's a seconder who's a champion of amateur sports, okay, there I see Councillor Santos put her name in. Okay. Does anyone want to speak to the liability issue? Hearing none, we'll put this motion forward. This is just to support their request to the province. Any objections?
No, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to speak to the motion.
Okay, to the liability motion? Okay. Councillor Pelleschi.
There's other speakers before me, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, but I think those speakers are to the general topic of COVID-19, not the motion before us on supporting the request to the province to on civil liability around COVID-19.
Okay. So then I have the floor, Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, thank you very much for the organization for putting together the letter and then sending this. I'm very happy to support this. As a extremely proud Brampton resident growing up in the baseball system, seeing anything like this for sports in our community is always going to be well supported by me. I would like to just get an understanding from staff, and I'm using this as the opportunity to ask questions about organized sports in Brampton. I'm hearing that there's a lot of either if it's baseball, hockey, lacrosse, soccer, a lot of those organizations are looking to the city to try and get an understanding of when they can get back onto the fields and start to begin. I know that in Mississauga, their competitive baseball is currently in talks about starting up, and haven't heard too much from BMLA or any of the other organizations in Brampton. So I'd like to know how are those discussions going and what's currently happening with respect to staff and those organizations.
So Councillor Pelleschi, this does steer a little bit away from the motion, but we'll give you the discretion to continue. The clerk says it's close enough to liability in sports that it falls If Derek Boyce could speak to that, I believe this is all regulated by the province in terms of when these sports can start. So when they start in Mississauga and Brampton, it will be at the same time once the province allows competitive team sports. Right now it's only training, but Derek, if you could speak to that.
Absolutely. Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor. To Councillor Pelleschi's question, we have been in contact with the sports organizations, our affiliated groups, and our major sports groups throughout this process. And as Mayor Brown just recently said, so July 3rd and 4th, so today and over the next couple of days and early next week, we're going to be proactively reaching out to all our affiliated groups and major sports organizations to let them know that our soccer fields, cricket fields, baseball diamonds are available for practice only. So training and practice, no scrimmages or no games as per the province's directions, and with a limit of 10 people per field, per diamond, per cricket field or track and field. And so that will be happening over the next couple of days. We in Brampton, as you know, have taken a cautious approach, and so we didn't move to some of the phases where other parts of the province moved, reopened some of their assets a little bit earlier. But now that we're in phase two, we have opened up our assets, and so we are, as we speak, our rentals group is contacting those major users and affiliates, and then they'll be, as of next week, they'll be able to be back on the field, but as I stress, for training only as per the provincial directives.
Okay, and then in addition to that, Derek, and I'm hearing from, I guess, parents that have participated in team meetings and stuff, that some of the, I don't want to say blame, but some of the, in this case, liability, the organizations really don't want to, and I know that this particularly, what we're dealing with has to do with the insurance for the organization, but in the liability and the safety of the kids, either in a changing room or even on a bench or anything like that. How are we working? What are we doing with those organizations to ensure that, you know, the social distancing is being maintained and that all of our Brampton kids are safe and supported? What are some of the suggestions that are coming out of recreation?
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. Through you, Mr. Mayor. So we are working actively with our organization. So a couple of examples I'll give you. With the arenas opening up, change rooms will not be open. People will have to come dressed and ready to go. Egress and entry and egress will be directly from the arena in most cases. With our soccer fields, again, change rooms won't be open. Where possible, we'll have sanitization stations. And our sports unit has worked with a lot of the major sports organizations, especially the youth ones who are governed by provincial and national associations and governance bodies with return to play guidelines. And most of those are aligned with our thinking here in Brampton. And all of them do say, all of the ones that I've read say that, you know, the local public health officials, all organizations need to be adhering to what the public health officials are saying. So we are putting in place measures. I do know, to your point though, that some organizations are a bit apprehensive about COVID and their kids catching it. And so COVID can be transmitted anywhere, sports fields, grocery stores, wherever it may be. So we can't inherit that liability, so to speak, but we will do everything possible to make sure that the assets are used in a safe way, but it really is on the organization for them to make their own determinations as to whether or not they're going to return to play. Some organizations have said they're not returning to play because of the increased risk, and some will start to play, but we will put in place measures that facilitates a safe return, as safe as we can for those organizations to use our assets.
And for sure, thank you, Derek. And I know that nothing can be 100% until there are no longer any people that are infectious with COVID. So I think everybody recognizes that. Some of the other things that I've heard is that the city is saying to parents that only one parent can come in with the child. When we're talking about hockey, coming dressed isn't new to anybody playing hockey, because that's what we used to do when we couldn't dress ourselves before a hockey game. So You know, I don't see that as an issue, but some of the things they're saying that they're prohibiting parents from either from even being at a practice, or one parent is allowed to come to a game. Is that the city or is that each organization? Do you know?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. So there are no games allowed. So that's the first thing. So it'll only be practices and training. And so some organizations have explicitly said that depending on the asset will be different. So for arenas, for instance, we aren't allowing spectators from the city's standpoint. It's just the coaches and the players on the ice in and out for those activities. For something I'd say like a soccer training, if a parent wanted to watch their kid play soccer on a field, on the sidelines, that's an interesting question. I mean, they can socially distance. Technically, they wouldn't be on the field, so they wouldn't be over the 10 limit. But again, we're really trying to abide as closely as possible to the provincial guidelines of a maximum of 10 people. So where possible, where we can facilitate that, that will happen. But a lot of the organizations have their own policies in place, as so do the like the BHI, for instance. Yesterday, I think they were speaking to us, and they said they're not allowing parents inside, and that works well in terms of where we are in our phased approach to reopening safely for residents.
Excellent. That's great, Derek. Thank you very much again, Mr. Mayor. Full support of this motion going forward.
Okay. Councillor Williams wants to speak to the liability motion.
Hi, thank you. Through the mayor, just a question about dance studios, gymnastic clubs, and cheer clubs. They are also sport, and I'm just wondering if that is also included in this discussion as well, as it relates to some of the our city facilities that are used for organizations that do run those type of sporting activities.
Okay, I'll let Diana Sue speak to this. She was the one that drafted this.
Through the mayor, the resolution speaks to sports and social clubs and community groups. So I think the resolution covers that. I'm not sure if Councillor Williams was speaking directly to whether the motion covers it or whether she was the councillor was asking about our rec centers. But to the extent that the question relates to whether the motion would encompasses those types of groups and organizations, the intention and the way in which it's drafted is drafted broadly in order to capture those types of organizations.
Okay, thank you. Through the mayor, I think that's great that we are including dance studios and cheer clubs and gymnastics. I know that there has been much discussion and concern with their ability to offer specific skill development and participate in competitions and such from these organizations and clubs because they are responsible for children and making sure that their kids are safe and even the question around how many people they can have or how many kids they can have in their groups during practices and events. So it's good to hear that they are included because we do not want to forget about those types of activities and especially the connection and the skill and the sport that is being discussed today. So it's good to hear that we're really considering dance studios, cheer clubs, and gymnastics that's included in this. And I'm wondering, just for the wording of the motion, if it says community groups, but I'm wondering if we could amend it just to specify dance, cheer, and gymnastics as well, just so that it's being considered, because I think some people might interpret sport not including that type of sport.
If Diana wants to speak to that.
Through the chair, if you wish to amend the motion to include specific items to be referenced in the correspondence to the provincial government, happy to have those amendments made. In terms of whether or not those types of activities are permissible, that's something that is not within the scope of this motion. So that would be something that you'd have to look to the regulations to determine whether those types of organizations can currently be be operated, but with respect to whether or not we advocate for the types of assistance and limitations of liability in relation to those types of activities, I don't see a concern in amending the resolution to expressly refer to those.
Okay, hearing that, then we take it as a friendly amendment, as long as it doesn't diminish the ask that we've been asked to do on behalf of these organizations. Then that's, and if Diana says that's fine, then I view that as friendly.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Williams. Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, and I think maybe I can help shed some light on this, and I think what Councillor Williams is referring to is the fact that it's truly unfortunate that dance, gymnastics, and cheer are not recognized as sports in the provincial eyes. And I think that's what Councillor Williams is referring to, and I fully support not only including this, but maybe having a further conversation about, you know, as a proud dad of two daughters that are in competitive cheer, I can tell a lot of people that cheer is gymnastics and dance is definitely a sport. So I'm happy to maybe have a conversation with Councillor Williams and maybe Diana Seuss to have a further motion requesting that the province starts recognizing these sports as actual sports in the province of Ontario. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you. Any objections to the motion? The motion carries. We also have the correspondence. Can we just accept that now too from CARP? Any motion?
Mr. Mayor, the first correspondence will be accepting the one that's on the screen okay. from the yep. baseballs.
This is moved by Councillor Santos and Williams. Any objections? Motion carries. The next piece of correspondence, this is moved by Councillor Willens and Bowman in regards to CARP. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Before we get to general questions, I think Councillor Medeiros had a general motion for this part.
Thank you, Mary Brown. I actually had, I was asked to add an agenda item for Derek Boyce to do a presentation, just to a quick presentation to Council as an update to what will be reopening in terms of dates and timelines, if that's okay, Mayor.
Okay.
And just quickly before I hand it over to Derek, Mayor, just a quick update to members of Council. This morning, there was mention of during the press conference of a survey. So Brampton residents came back with 4,540 responses regarding our online survey about reopening. It's the highest participation achieved for an online survey at the City of Brampton. And really want to recognize all the hard work from my councillor colleagues, because certainly this reflects the engagement in each task force. And I think certainly when we did public consultations with each co-chairs, you know, the response following, just as a reminder, youth, seniors, businesses, arts and cultural groups, is really a reflection of council and certainly yourself, Mayor, in the way that we've consulted and engaged with the community. Just very quickly, key findings, 87% prefer a slow, cautious approach to reopening city facilities. 82% prefer accessing city services online during the pandemic. 88% would like as many services as possible available online, so residents are not required to visit city facilities in person and have other options. 86% support limiting the number of people allowed inside city facilities to promote physical distancing. 71% would like events to be either modified or held virtually during the summer, and 84% are open to attending online events hosted by the city. And just very quickly, residents were most supportive of the following safety measures in city facilities: increasing cleaning and sanitizing processes, limits on the number of users permitted at any one time, moving equipment to ensure 2 meters of distance, and requiring the use of personal protective equipment, i.e. masks and gloves. So thank you very much, and I will hand it over now to Derek.
Derek?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So I'll try to go fairly quickly through this presentation as Mayor Brown did announce this morning in his comments some of these dates, but I'll highlight a couple of things for your reference as you may be getting calls from your constituents about some of these, and I think we can answer some of those questions. So if we can move to the next slide, that would be great, please. Thank you. So I'll just go quickly through the provincial legislation upon which we're basing all these decisions on, and then go through a number of the amenities that will be opening as part of the stage two reopening plan. Next slide, please. So the provincial legislation that was allows us to move to phase two allows us to open outdoor splash pads and wading pools. Team sports are permitted to be conducted, but no scrimmages or games, only for training, and then limited or modified services within community centers. And you'll see as I go through the presentation that we have taken a very literal approach to this and translation of these guidelines, and in order to keep the things that you see on the right, to make sure that we're practicing physical distancing, that we can clean our surfaces and increase that frequency, and make sure that we try to keep our facilities safe as possible for the users that may come through. Next slide, please. So camps we will be offering camps this summer through the Recreation Division. Camps will start July 13th and registration will open June 29th. A couple of things that are important to note with camps. Number one is that we have limited camp spots available, and so we are going to have no more than 10, you're not allowed any more than 10 people in a cohort. And as such, we will have maximum of 8 participants and 2 instructors per cohort at each in each camp grouping. In order to accommodate parents, we have extended camp hours over the, so traditionally camp usually runs from 9 till 4 p.m. We are going to be run from 8:45 to 5:15, and that will be at no additional cost. This is in due part to the fact that we don't have the ability to offer before and after care because it would lead to co-mingling of participants in different cohorts. So in order to allow for parents to have a better offering and get to and from work and drop off their kids, we've extended the time. Our camp leaders will be wearing masks, and as much as possible, participants will be involved in individual activities, outdoor activities, each having their own equipment and tools to utilize. And if there is equipment that is used by multiple, it'll be sanitized thoroughly before use of another cohort. So camps will be July 13th. And again, the visibility will be open as of tomorrow, but registration starts online only. So there's no, as per Councillor Medeiros' statements that he's from the survey, those surveys indicate a lot of what the measures that we are taking. And I'm glad to see that they're supported by the wider community. And so it'll be online or through the phone through 311 for registration. Those are the only two methods that will be available for registration. The last point I'll make about camps is because we're trying to keep a safe environment for the participants in our centers, there'll be nothing else going on in the centers throughout the summer. So no pools will be open, no fitness centers, no gymnasiums. At locations where we have arenas that will be utilized, again, we'll have separate entry and egress from the arenas points so that there's no commingling of those participants with our camp participants, and camp participants will have separate drop-off and pick-up points. So we are doing everything possible to ensure that we offer as safe as possible camp experience and that parents feel comfortable leaving their children with us. Next slide, please. Arenas, again, we began reinstalling some ice at 5 of our pads across the city. So 2 at Cassie Campbell, 2 at South Fletcher's and Earnscliff Community Center. So that ice is just about done and ready to go, and we will be ICE will be available for use as of June next week, June 29th. And where our rentals group is working with our major user groups in both figure skating and hockey, our major users, to apprise them of this and work through some of the logistics that are involved in that. Again, maximum of 10 participants, and that includes the coach. So If you have two coaches, eight participants, three coaches, seven participants, so on and so forth. And our rental contracts are going to stipulate for all sports organizations, no scrimmages or games. We need to be make that very clear. It's only training, and there will be no access to change rooms. So as we previously discussed, you know, it's in and out with the hockey equipment or figure skating and on the ice, off the ice right away. Next slide, please. We're also pleased to announce that our sports fields will be opening as of July 3rd. So as I mentioned, our rentals unit is contacting our major outdoor users and affiliates currently over the next couple of days. Our parks team is getting our fields ready to be utilized. And again, the fields will be utilized for training purposes only. No scrimmages or games are allowed. There will be no change room access, and we will be scheduling to limit crossover. So whereas in the past we might have done, you have a 1 to 2 o'clock slot and then somebody has a 2 o'clock till 3 o'clock, we'll probably put a half an hour gap in between to allow one group to leave and the other group to come on. So make sure that the crossover again limits the commingling of participants in order to keep everyone safe. And outdoor sanitization stations where possible will be implemented, along with signage on our fenced facilities. So that will be July 3rd and 4th. And then our general public will be able to do spot rentals, those one-off rentals, as of July 6th to rent fields and outdoor amenities. And fields, I will say, this is sports fields, track and field, and does include baseball diamonds for those who, just to be clear. Next slide, please. Basketball courts. So we are opening up our basketball court, the installation of the hoops. We had taken the hoops away from all of our facilities. So we are putting those back on starting on Monday. And that installation will take about a week to get throughout the city. But our major courts, we'll start with our major courts first. And we're going to be putting signage on our fence facilities, which are our major ones, to again, no games allowed. We're going to encourage people to play not play pickup or not scrimmage, but play games like Around the World or horse or shooting drills, to allow kids to be active and out there, but again, limiting that physical distance, enforcing that physical distancing where possible. And again, sanitization stations will be installed where possible, where they can be affixed to amenities at outdoor basketball courts. So we, again, with the great weather coming, we want to get people outside and active. Next slide, please. Splash pads. Our splash pads are set to reopen this weekend. Social distancing and physical distancing rules apply to our splash pads. We're going to ask people to stay 2 meters apart. We'll be installing sanitization stations. Change rooms will not be open, but washrooms at the facilities will be open, as we a couple of weeks ago opened major park washrooms. What we're doing with washrooms, just to allow people to understand, we have increased the frequency of cleaning in our washrooms. At most of our locations, we have dedicated washroom attendants who will go in and clean frequently and sanitize and monitor the monitor our washroom facility. So at our splash pads that do have adjacent washrooms, the washrooms will be open, but change rooms will not be open. So we ask people to come change and with their personal gear ready to go and enjoy those splash pads as we enjoy the hot weather. Next slide, please. And these are just the locations of our splash pads, again, throughout the city, the major ones where people enjoy. So next slide, please. As the mayor mentioned, Professors Lake, we are working to get Professors Lake up and running. We are recalling staff. We started that yesterday, and we'll be training staff over the next couple of weeks. We'll have further news to come on Professors Lake, and we will get it open as soon as possible. It is a little bit more complex with implementing physical distancing measures at the beach, and so we are working around the clock with our staff to figure out how we do that. We do have a plan in place, but we want to make sure that it's a sustainable plan, and if we move to stage 3, we also want to make sure that it's a plan that allows us to move easily there. So more news to come on Professors Lake, but when that does happen, we will have a methodology that allows that Professors Lake to be utilized, and it probably will include some sort of reservation type system so that we can control capacity and control utilization a little bit more than we would if it was just open regularly. So Professors Lake on a hot day can see anywhere up to 2,500 participants in a normal year. So we obviously don't want that happening. So we are really thinking through the plan at Professors Lake. And so we ask that you be patient with us as we endeavor to get that up and running as soon as possible. And the last slide, please. Yes, and this slide just speaks to your communication. So we've been working with Strategic Communications. We've been attached at the hip and really working through getting SIUs out there, social media tiles, signage, our social media. I thank you to all you counselors that have been retweeting and sending some of those, that information through, working with our 311 call center, who's at the front line answering a lot of questions. So a lot of different communication vehicles and mediums available for us to communicate that to the residents. Obviously the mayor's news conference on Wednesday goes a long way, and Councillor Medeiros hosting his Facebook Live sessions and updating residents. So as much as possible, we're trying to make sure residents have consistent information that about what's open, what's closed, and what's available. So that concludes this presentation. There was another presentation, but I don't think we need to go in depth for that. It really just focused around some of the measures we were talking about camps. I will leave that with you for your perusal. I think the only major things I'd like to mention about camps is our capacity is very limited. So whereas, we're going to be running at about 20 to 25% of capacity in our camps and our cohorts. So registration will be limited. We are not opening any registration to non-residents. So only residents will be able to register this summer. We want to make sure we have spots available for all our Brampton residents. We have extensive measures in place around if participants exhibit COVID symptoms or if leaders or staff do. And so isolation rooms, making sure testing is done promptly. All these measures are happening behind the scenes to ensure that we have a safe environment. And so if I can just take maybe 20 seconds to speak to that, the reason for the limited cohort, so I will give an example at Brampton Soccer Center, for instance, we probably can have about what we call 9 cohorts or 9 groupings. And so those groupings will never mix. They'll be at separate field houses in separate areas. They'll use separate change rooms. They'll use separate washrooms. And so if those 8 participants and 2 leaders are always together, if by chance there is somebody exhibiting symptoms or somebody tests positive, we are then able to isolate that cohort without having to shut down the entire building or the entire camp, because we can be relatively sure that they haven't mixed with other individuals. We also will be have isolation rooms available at our centers. And so there's extensive processes in place behind the scenes to allow that to happen. The only other 2 points I'd make real quick, with your indulgence, is we have modified the ages this year. We want to hit the people that are most in need for summer camp. So traditionally 4 to 13 would be where we would be targeting. This year it's 4 to 10, 4 to 10 years of old. And as I already mentioned about the extended hours, so we hope that that will help parents in terms of those that have to return to work and need our summer camp services. In the presentation, you'll also see that, there is a financial hit to this. But of course, everything we do in recreation is not about money. And so we have kept the price of the courses the same, camp courses the same, even though our cost will increase with the additional labor necessary to support residents. But we feel that at a time where people are, some people are struggling and the economy is struggling, that it would be unfair to parents to raise that price. So we are keeping the price of our summer camp the same, but there will be increased attention to kids, increased labor attached to that to ensure a safe environment. So I won't go, that's it in a nutshell. If there are any questions, I'm happy to take that and take them both online or offline. But hopefully that will give you a sense of where we are heading with our parks and recreation over the stage 2. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor.
Question from Councillor Williams.
I believe Councillor Singh was above me. He would like to talk on COVID update. Councillor Singh?
I think this is, Councillor Singh, is your question to Derek?
Mine's just about COVID-19 update.
Okay, so Councillor Williams, why don't you finish up your question to Derek so we can move on to the general questions?
Sure, thank you. I'll be really quick. Derek, just to clarification, we're not opening the play structures at the parks, is that correct?
That is through you, Mr. Mayor. That is correct, Councillor Williams. The playground equipment will continue to be wrapped and structured as per the provincial guidelines.
Okay, thank you. Through the mayor, I'm just wondering with the splash pads, just because, you know, in order to activate the splash pads, you have to press that button. I'm just curious to know why the decision was made to open splash pads and not the play structures. I think it goes together, and some of these splash pads are located in the same place as the play structures, and I just...
So, Councillor Williams, that's under the provincial order. The provincial order says that play structures can't be opened yet.
Okay, even though as a city, we've decided to not move as quickly on certain things within our purview. Okay, I think it's a great plan, and I'm looking forward to seeing how this is going to all roll out. And I just wanted to make a comment. Thank you for considering the age group from 4 to 10. I think it's going to really help parents out that have multiple ages in their home, and the parents who have little kids in daycare, but then need to have something to do for their older kids throughout the summer. So I think this is going to be great, and thank you for the update.
Okay, Councillor Singh, and thank you, Derek Boyce, for the presentation. And now, Derek, let's go to general questions. And the list for Councillor Bowman's a first for general questions.
Thank you very much, through you, Mr. Mayor. I believe on the survey that Councillor Medeiros was talking about too, there was a question on there about post-COVID assistance, especially for the social task force, which Councillor Santos and I are co-chairs of. And excuse me, I believe the response rate was 43% of people said that they were going to need post-COVID assistance. We're running into a little bit of difficulty now because we are finding that a lot of the people who have been working on the social task force are now being put back into their regular positions, back with the city as other things open up. So I think we need to look carefully. If 43% of people are still going to need the post-COVID assistance, such as food deliveries, which we're currently doing 100 a week of, we're going to have to look at some either part-time work or something to wind this thing down to a point where we can say, okay, at this point, we will not be doing any more deliveries. So I just want to make sure that that is in the plan and that that is happening, because I don't want to have to be the guy or the person who says that as of tomorrow, we're not making any more deliveries because we don't have employees or volunteers to do that. So that's my first item that I think we need to look at that carefully from the social task force point of view. Secondly, this is a question to do with the region. Now that we're moving out, and I believe Councillor Pelleschi is on waste, are the centers going to start accepting larger items now that they have not been accepting for a long time? Couches, chairs. And the reason I'm asking for that is because every garbage day I continue to see them sitting at the curb, and they sit there and sit there. So with the lifting of restrictions now into phase two, does that include our centers or the waste management picking those things up? Does anyone have an answer for that? Okay, I guess not. Perhaps that can be brought up at the region tomorrow then. Final thing was, and it's got to do with Derek's presentation, and that is, as we go through this and we continue to open up some of our facilities, are we in turn working with the school board to open up some of their facilities? Because a lot of the schools have basketball courts and basketball nets on their property as well. And I think it's no secret to Derek or anybody else that we've got a big issue here in the Peel Village Park with the basketball net that was put up there. And kids playing till very, very late hours or early hours in the morning. Very rambunctious. There was a number of times that they've jumped the fence and gone in to play basketball there. So if the basketball nets were open at the neighborhood schools, that would possibly alleviate some of the problems that we're having in this particular tennis court that was converted to a multi-purpose court. So are we working with the school boards to ensure that they have also opened up some of their facilities outside?
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Councillor Bowman. We work with the school board extensively, meet with them quarterly. Unfortunately, our last meeting was before this recent announcement. So you raise a good point. What I will do is have our recreation and park staff liaise with our contacts in the school board just to advise them of what we're doing. In some respects, they have been looking to us for guidance. So hopefully it is the end of the school year, but hopefully they can get some of their equipment back up, because I think they had taken away some of their hoops as well. So we will make that a priority to contact our contacts. And obviously the decision rests with them. We can't force them, but we will let them know what we've done, and hopefully that will be a catalyst for them as well.
Okay. And the only reason I asked, Derek, is because the taxes pay for the schools as well. So, you know, as much as we have our facilities, the school board facilities are paid for by taxpayer dollars as well. And I don't see any reason why some of those can't be opened up outside, for instance, the tennis courts and the basketball hoops. So if somebody can just get me an answer on the large items on the garbage, whether that's later or tomorrow after region, that would be fantastic. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Singh.
Can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. I just wanted to take a moment and acknowledge the work of the clerk's office and the mayor's certificate during COVID-19. I just had to commend the responsiveness from staff, and you know, the ones that were urgent got dealt with, and the ones that aren't urgent are getting delayed as they should, and that's fine. But I did want to take a moment to acknowledge staff's work. You know, all the issues that residents had were resolved, and they were impressed, and I was impressed with the responsiveness out of the clerk's office. So thank you.
Okay, thank you. No other questions? Okay, we have a motion to accept the COVID-19 report, moved by Councillor
Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I had my name up, I believe.
Okay, we missed that. But Councillor Presente, please go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor. Just to finish up on some business from last week's COVID-19 updates, we had made a request of transit staff to look at fare capping and to deal with the fact that we're getting reports of residents sometimes taking or requiring more than 2 hours to complete a trip, which can sometimes result in them being billed more than once to complete a trip from point A to point B. We had asked transit staff to come back to us with a potential solution, and I believe that Alex Milojevic, our chief of transit, has drafted a motion for us to consider, and I'd like to ask for the clerk to put that up on the screen.
So, Councillor, it will be coming up on the screen momentarily.
And sure. Thank you. While that's happening, I just want to thank Alex for putting this together so quickly. It really does address an important need here in the city, and I think it does a lot to help differentiate our service levels here in the city, and solves a problem that is really happening right now. I was at one of the transit hubs just last night, and I witnessed 30 people standing in a line
And when the bus pulled in, about half of the line was able to get onto the bus, and the remaining half are waiting for the next one. And so this is certainly a real problem. So I'll just quickly read the motion because I don't want this to take too long. Whereas physical distancing measures amidst the COVID-19 pandemic has currently reduced the number of people who can be safely accommodated on a Brampton Transit bus, and Brampton Transit currently offers a 2-hour transfer window for riders after having paid their fare. And due to the reduced capacity of Brampton Transit buses, more buses are full and unable to accommodate riders, and more people are having to wait longer to board a bus to a point where they may have to pay another fare to finish their journey. And that the introduction of fare capping for Presto users will help limit the number of extra fares that a resident might pay if their journeys take longer. Therefore, be it resolved that Brampton Transit implements a Presto customer loyalty program, whereby once a customer pays for 12 single rides on Brampton Transit during any 1 week, Monday to Sunday period, using their Presto card, each subsequent ride on Brampton Transit is free for the remainder of that week, and that transit staff periodically review the impacts on revenue and adjust the loyalty program as required to ensure those impacts are not significant. That is the motion, Mr. Mayor, and I don't know if Alex wants to comment, and certainly he is ready to answer any questions. Thank you.
And if I may, through you, Mayor.
Okay.
Just very briefly, if I can just provide a brief 2-minute update, I think would be very helpful. Thank you, Councillor Vicente, for that. And again, through you, Mayor, in terms of the whole discussion that we had last week at committee, we looked at the Presto program, and we feel that this is an appropriate measure that we can take place to mitigate some of the concerns and the capacity issues and the fare issues that evolve around that. The financial implication we feel is minimal at this point, and the motion reads towards the end that allows us a bit of flexibility if we see a different pattern as there's an uptake. Just quickly, though, if I can, on the recovery plan and the increase in ridership and resources around all that, July 2nd, the recovery plan is taking effect as the economy opens up and more people are traveling on our buses. We're already experiencing, as many of you have probably seen, the capacity issues with physical distancing at our terminals and our buses. We have been working with Peel Public Health, and a good part is that we are looking at increasing our capacity of our buses to potentially a fully seated load as of July 2nd, once we implement the mandatory mask requirement, which will help alleviate some of the pressures. I will say, though, that our ridership is probably around 35 to 40% from pre-COVID levels, which is the highest in the neighboring municipalities. Capacity limitations on our buses mean, though, that that our operators are carrying customers, and the demand is a lot more than what we can provide today. And just very briefly, if I can just add that our 2019 service levels, we had a lot of customers asking when are we going to implement back the service routes that have been canceled and still are canceled. So we've been working collectively with our with the mask mandate that's happening July 2nd, with the potential increase in capacity of full seated loads, and potentially further after that, working closely with Peel Public Health and their recommendations. And we're hopeful that we can initiate rehiring some of our staff that we've lost to attrition through the last 3 or 4 months, just simply because of the training programs and the hiring process, to get to a level where we can meet the demand that we expect coming up in the near future. And lastly, if I can just say that we are going to be reporting back to council, because I know there's expectation for some of service levels to be put in based on the 2020 approved budget. We haven't implemented any of those changes. We want to potentially defer some of those, but we will come back with a report on some of those deferrals in weeks or a couple of months to come to kind of finalize that part. I'll stop there. Thank you for allowing me to get to.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention and thank our resident Sylvia Menezes for bringing this to our attention and for giving us the opportunity to improve our service level. Thank you.
Okay, we have a request for a recorded vote, and we have a question from Councillor Bowman.
Yeah, just a real quick question. Is this intended as a stopgap measure, or is this forever and ever, amen?
What through you, Mayor, what we're proposing is that we implement this measure, and it may be another suite of programs that we offer to our customers. We feel that there's minimal impact. It may be something else where either a person can buy a weekly pass, benefit slightly more than this particular loyalty program, but the loyalty program just gives another option to our customers. So if there's a negative impact or no impact or minimal impact, we'd recommend keeping this in place even post-COVID.
Okay, thank you. I'm just concerned that when we get to budget time, that this is something that we would have to address if it is going to be a permanent program at budget time as well. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Bowman. Councillor Williams.
Hi, yes. Question through the mayor to staff. With the Presto cards, you can share Presto cards, right? They're like people can share them with anybody. It's not like they have a picture attached to it that you're going to make sure that it's going to be used by the same person every time.
No, that's correct. A Presto card may be shared with others, and it's typical. Again, through your mayor, it's typical as if somebody were buying a weekly pass, for example, that could be done as well.
Mm-hmm. So if somebody buys one pass, shares it with their family, then once they get to 12 rides in a day or two or 2 days or whatever, the rest of the week will be free. Is that what I'm reading here?
Yes. Yeah, so once you use 12 rides on it within the Monday to Sunday period, then the rest of the rides would be free. And that is correct, Councillor Williams. And it's much like a weekly pass. So today somebody can buy a weekly pass for the same period. And it's actually equal to probably around 11 rides when you look at $34 fee for a weekly pass. And the same thing could be done with the weekly pass as well. There are minimal in terms of that percentage, but again, that could be done, correct?
Okay. Is there a way to track how many times that card is used after the free period, just to see if there's an increase on that card? Or is there a way to track that for all riders?
Absolutely. Through the mayor, there is a way of tracking the usage of loyalty programs and or weekly pass, and that's something we monitor. And the provision, I believe it's the last line on the motion, gives that flexibility to be able to adjust accordingly if there was any significant changes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Williams. Now the recorded vote, clerk.
Recorded vote on the motion moved by Councillor Vasante, seconded by Councillor Medeiros. Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Councillor Vasante?
Yes.
Councillor Willens?
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman?
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
That motion carries unanimously 11 to 0.
Okay. And this takes us to our next item.
Sorry, Mr. Mayor, just before we leave this, I think we have to receive your update and receive Derek's presentation.
Okay.
I wasn't sure if we...
A move by Councillor Bowman, second by Councillor Willens to receive Derek Boyce's presentation. Any objections? Motion carries. Now the motion to receive my report. Do we have that on the screen?
That's the same motion.
Oh, same motion, okay. Okay, that takes us to the next item. Reports of corporate officials. Recommendations for support of not-for-profit and small for-profit business tenants within the city-owned buildings in response to COVID-19. Do any members have any questions? We'll get the motion on the floor. Okay, this is just extending the deferral for 3 months. Any objections? This moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by Councillor Williams. Seeing no objections, the motion carries. This takes us to 10.2, Changing acceptable payment methods for property tax and building division fees. We'll put that motion on the screen. Moved by Councillor Bowman, seconded by Councillor Willens. Are there, oh, Councillor Bowman would like to comment on this.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I'd just like to thank the staff who worked on this. I've been in consultation with them for a number of months regarding this, and it just, I guess when COVID hit, it became all that more important, especially with money, actual money handling. So I thank them for bringing this forward, and I'm pleased to move the motion.
Thank you. Any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. That takes us to 10.3, which was done on consent. 10.4 was on consent. 10.5 was on consent. 10.6, request to begin procurement hiring of a general contractor for the demolition of the existing Howden Recreation Center. Do we have motion is on the table? Councillor Williams and Councillor Fortini. Any objections? Motion carries. That takes us to 10.7, summer closure of Brampton downtown streets. Do any members have any questions or comments? We'll put the motion on the floor, moved by Councillor Medeiros and Santos. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. This takes us to, have we done 10.8? 10.8 was consent, 10.9 was on consent. That takes us to committee reports, number 12. We're now at item 12, committee reports or minutes. We have three committee reports in the form of minutes or recommendations on today's agenda. Under council's meeting procedures, the committee or section chair introduces their committee report or minutes and summarizes the matters considered and now brought forward to council today for ratification. The audit committee met on June 16th. The committee minutes are here for council's consideration. I'll now pass the chair to Councillor Medeiros to lead council in the consideration of the committee minutes.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of audit committee, you have before you the minutes from the audit committee. Are there any questions or comments? No, back to you, Mayor.
Thank you. We have a motion moved by Councillor Medeiros, seconded by Councillor Santos to approve the committee minutes. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Our only set of minutes is item 12.1. The Committee of Council met on June 17th. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. I'll now pass the chair to the respective section chairs in order of consideration. We have Councillor Vicente, who chaired the Economic and Development section. Councillor Singh chaired the Corporate Services section. Councillor Vicente chaired the Public Works Engineering section. Councillor Santos chaired the Community Services section. Council will then consider a motion to approve the recommendations in its entirety after all section chairs have concluded their summaries and any resulting council questions. So to the committee chairs, Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, Mayor. Do any members of council have any questions with regards to the economic developments and culture section or the public works and engineering sections of the June 17th, 2020 meeting? Seeing none, Mr. Mayor, I'll just ask a quick question just to make sure that we are clear. It was at the June 17th meeting that we asked the transit staff to provide the motion or the steps which we just passed during the mayor's COVID-19 updates. I just want to make sure that it's understood then that there is no further report that is required, seeing as a motion that we just passed a few moments ago fulfills the request that council made last week, and that was fulfilled today. Alex, can you just provide a quick comment to that?
Absolutely, through the chair. Absolutely, if this meets in council direction, which has been given now, would not necessitate a report to come back. And I was remiss on maybe not mentioning when we can do that. Working with Presto, we understand that we can go live after some technical changes on July 6th to implement that.
Thank you very much, Alex. With that, Mayor, back to you.
Thank you. Next up, Councillor Singh.
Members of Council, do you have any questions for the Corporate Services section? Hearing none, I pass it on to you, Mayor Brown.
Councillor Santos.
Members of Council, any questions regarding community services section? Seeing none, back to you, Mayor Brown.
Okay. So I have a motion moved by Councillor Singh, second by Councillor Vicente to approve the committee minutes. We have a question from Paul Vicente.
No, Mr. Mayor, I asked a question when I was up. Thank you.
Okay. Any objections? Motion carries. That takes us to the Planning Development Committee, met on June 22nd. The committee recommendations are here for Council's consideration and approval. The committee minutes will be presented to the July 8th Council meeting for receipt. I will now pass the chair to the Councillor Medeiros to lead Council on the consideration of the committee minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of Council, you have before you the minutes of the Planning Development Committee. Are there any questions or comments? Okay, back to you, Mayor.
Thank I have you. A question.
Oh.
Well, okay, go ahead.
So the question that I had was in relation to the to Bill 108 and how it affects cash in lieu of parkland, and then also the section, I think it's section 11 under the Planning Act, the ability to collect funds for to put towards any kind of low income, no, affordable housing.
I think so. Do we have planning staff?
Is Richard there?
Through the chair, it's Richard here. So we've got Bob, our director of policy, on the line, who can probably speak to Bill 108 and the implications for that.
Hello, everyone. Bob Bierke, Director of Policy Planning here. I think, Councillor, maybe it would be best, some of the details of that aren't completely rolled out yet in the regulations. For affordable housing, if you're thinking, and I'm just going to have to stop my head, section 37 in terms of bonusing for affordable housing isn't available anymore. There are potentially some opportunities through the community development permit process for us to bring in some bylaws. There are sort of evolving discussions around the DCs and which pieces in terms of community benefits can be used. We're actually on a call earlier today with some of the ministry officials, and I think there's some changes that might be coming out. So it might be better for us to get back to you with some specifics to respond to that, just to make sure that we're all clear on the language that we're using.
Okay. Okay, thanks, Bob. So still nothing on cash in lieu. We're not sure how that affects, how that comes into Bill 108. And then the other question that I had was, when an application becomes stale in the report, and I can't seem to find, I'm only looking at the minutes here, I can't seem to pull up
the report. So is the closeout procedure
that we were are we looking at the 6-month closeout? Like Mississauga and some of the other municipalities, or what was staff recommending?
So in the report, what we're recommending is that we would actually bring, we provide notice, but then we would bring a report to council to formally close those out. And I think they'd be done with a number of them at the same time. But we wouldn't be doing it administratively like some of the others do. This provides a little more definite conclusion to the application process, because there really isn't a provision in the Act to do the closeouts exactly the way that some of the other municipalities have chosen to do it.
And so what's the time frame that you would bring that back to council?
Trying to go off the top of my head, I think we're a year.
I can advise on that. This is Alan Parsons here, through Mr. Chairman, through the Councillor Plushy. It is essentially a 6-month time frame, Councillor. Really, we've identified within the report that really after 4 months, we'll be engaging the applicants where we see that they've been inactive for that period of time to essentially provide fair warning that that we do need a response from them really within the next couple of months and or the, a resubmission from them perhaps as well to identify really why it's been inactive, to give us some understanding of that, or to simply activate it again. If there's no response that's adequate really 2 months thereafter, so then totaling a period of 6 months, at that point in time, we would like to deem the application inactive and would prepare to bring the report along with others of that type as well that are also inactive forward through to council for your decision on it.
Okay, and thank you. And so it could essentially be plus or minus a year, given you know how many other active reports or inactive reports need to come to council. If council decided to approve, I guess the recommendation would be to cancel the application. If council made that decision, and then the applicant then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, decided that he or she wanted to come back and reactivate it. Do the DCs to be paid, are they updated to current, or are they still backdated based on Bill 108?
Through the chair, they're through the current DCs at the time that they reapply.
Okay. And what prohibits an applicant to come to council to get them to not reactivate, but reverse council's decision to provide an extension?
So through the chair, then when the staff report comes to council, certainly council can pull any one of the applicants out of the staff report that staff are bringing forward, and can decide on certain circumstances that the application should be extended, or that they can be extended to take advantage of the DCs that were before. So there's an opportunity for anybody to put a deputation into council to seek that. Mm-hmm. At the time of when staff are bringing forward a staff report with a list of those that we would recommend basically be, in essence, canceled.
Okay. So I'm just, I'm trying to be a little bit proactive here, and I don't have a crystal ball, but if I did, I can see an applicant coming forward asking for the reconsideration. So I just want to ensure that, you know, like Alan said, within those 4 months that we're reaching out, if we don't hear anything back, then, you know, the 6 months when we decide that it's becoming inactive, we obviously want some kind of response from them saying, no, we've abandoned the application or whatever. So maybe when it comes to council in a year, you could outline if we have five and one of the applicants has not responded. I think that would be good for members of council to kind of see that, just in case that applicant in the future thereafter would like council to reconsider.
Through the chair to Councillor Pleshy, exactly. That's what we want to be able to do. We really want development activity to happen. Mm-hmm. And we don't want development to be stalled out, and we want to encourage developers to move forward with their applications. So yes, they will certainly have an opportunity through the process whereby when they get notified that their application is stalled out after that 4 month period, they'll also get notified that there's a report going to council in which staff will be recommending if after the 6 month period there's no activity, that file be closed out. So they'll have an opportunity for a deputation to council in which they can make their case for why they should be granted an extension. If I can also speak to the cash and lieu, councillor, yes, the community benefits regulations, we do not have that yet, which rolls all section 37 of bonusing and cash and lieu and all those elements into that program. We don't have that yet from the province. So once we have that, we'll be able to report to council in terms of what does that mean for us.
what does it mean in terms of our ability to move forward with, you know, future community parks? What does it mean in terms of other elements that we rely on, basically those components of the Planning Act that we could rely on today?
Okay, and thank you for that, Richard. And I think that I'd just like to say Bill 108 and has been so complicated from the beginning. And I think the comments around Bill 108 every time anybody asks about it is, we fully don't understand, we fully don't have all of the information yet. Like, that's what it should be called. It should be Bill, we don't have the information yet. I guess what I'm looking for, what I'm asking now is just, if we can have some sort of, I don't know if we need a workshop or maybe just a staff report coming back to the future council of, you know, slowly as we, because Bill 108 is pretty significant to municipalities, if we can have a better understanding as we understand some of the sections of Bill 108, if staff can just be a little bit proactive in terms of when they understand it, I think council then would like to understand it, but I know how frustrating it is with staff right now in trying to figure out what Bill 108 actually means.
Through the chair to Councillor Plessy, agree 100% and would be happy to work with our government relations staff to provide a presentation to council on what we understand the current environment to look like.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Plessy. We have a motion on the floor from Councillor Madero, seconded by Councillor Fortini. Are there any objections? Seeing none, the motion carries. Next up is 13.1, right-of-way widening in the Village of Churchville Conservation District. This matter was referred from the June 22nd Planning and Development Committee meeting to today's agenda to allow staff to work on the ward councillors to suggest some additional language to clarify the intent of the proposed motion. Councillor Plessy, I understand you have some proposed wording changes that have been worked on with staff.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yep, the wording changes is there. I think I know the movers, Councillor Vincente had brought this forward. Councillor Willens had moved the motion. They were copied on the email for the changes. So I think they're okay with it. And if they're okay with it, I'm okay with it. Everybody's okay with it.
So can we have a second? I'm happy to second that. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. That takes us to correspondence. We've already dealt with the correspondence item from Terry Miller. Our next item of correspondence is item 14.2, Larissa Nutrick, Rat Rabies Science Operations Supervisor, Ministry of Natural Resources, dated June 15th, Rabies Control Operations during the COVID emergency. Motion moved by Councillor Santos and Williams to accept the correspondence. Are there any objections? Motion carries. We also have correspondence, actually already dealt with 14.3. That was during my update as well. That takes us to the referred matters list. The list is published quarterly on the meeting agenda and a copy is linked to each agenda, including the current listing of matters referred to city staff for further review and report back. Do any members have any questions about the referred matters list? Seeing none, we will move on to the next item. Public question period.
There are no questions.
Bylaws. We're now at the portion of the meeting dealing with the adoption of city bylaws to give effect to the council decisions made at this meeting. I have a motion moved by Councillor Williams, seconded by Councillor Fortini to approve bylaws 103-2020 to 115-2020. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will count in the affirmative. Seeing no objections, the motion carries. Next item of business is item 22, which we've already dealt with all the closed items.
So through you, Mr. Mayor, there just is a public motion we have to do to receive and acknowledge the minutes, 22.1 to 22.3, and confirm the directions, as well as just receive the information in 22.6 that was added to consent.
Okay. Is that on the screen? Moved by Councilor Madero, seconded by Councilor Bowman. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Our next item of business is item 23, the confirming bylaw. I have a motion moved by Councilor Bertini and seconded by Councilor Williams to approve the confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions from this meeting. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Hearing none, the motion carries. Our last item of business is item 24, adjournment. Council is next scheduled to meet Wednesday, July 8th at 1 p.m. I have a motion moved by Councilor Santos and seconded by Councilor Vicente. And I know we're still in an emergency, and so we may have meetings more frequently during the summer if there is new business for council to discuss. So just to make everyone aware of that, I know normally we only have two meetings in the summer, but there may be more if there are emergency issues. I have a motion moved by Councilor Santos and seconded by Councilor Vicente to adjourn today's meeting. Is there anyone opposed to this motion? Otherwise, your vote will count in the affirmative. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion is carried. The meeting is adjourned. Stay safe, stay healthy, and most importantly, please practice physical distancing.